Let's watch a video. Rick linked this to me. Wasabi Burger. He's going to talk about why you should play one shots. One shot is a derogatory term. People are put off when they hear one shot. Because in their mind, they're thinking it's a one shot is a certain deal. And I'm glad that he kind of brings this up. So that's the only reason. That's the only reason why I'm even watching this video in a YouTube vid of mine is because of it's his bisexual lighting that makes me want to watch more of his vids. Let's proceed.
I don't think my community necessarily plays RPGs the same way a lot of the mainstream people do, and that's not.
What are mainstream people? That was the other thing. What are mainstream players? Like, as in lamestream? Or as in high quality production value streams? I've watched his actual plays. They're just as terrible as everyone else's. So I don't know. I don't know what he's talking about. The mainstream is beneath him, yet he's at the bottom. So I don't know.
It's not me saying that we have a superior way of playing. I'm mostly just saying that we approach the hobby from a different perspective.
Maybe they use the VTT. He uses the VTT for the most part. You know, die rollers and crap. Maybe the mainstream still play indoors in people's houses at a table. Yeah. The gall.
I have personally dealt with real people and also people online acting like one-shots or short games are not really like true tabletop roleplay.
Yeah, they're filler games. So-and-so's not going to be here tonight, so we're just going to do a one-shot of something. You know, just pick a game. We'll just play any game. It doesn't matter. It's a one-shot. It doesn't matter. It doesn't... You know, your character, don't even try making a decent character, because you're probably going to die in the one-shot, you know. Your character doesn't matter for the one-shot. This is what happens when people hear the word one shot. This all goes through their head. Spoiler alert. Campaigns are just a series of one shots. The only difference is the GM is keeping your player character alive. Alive. That's the only difference between a one shot and a campaign. For the most part, your character won't die in a campaign. For the most part. There's a chance of your character appearing in the next one-shot of the campaign. One-shots meaning there's not much... Each episode of your campaign is just another combat game. Oh, another 4 hours of combat in a hallway. Nice. Way different than last session, which was 4 hours of combat in a forest.
Or at the very least, the tone I get is that they are like a lesser facsimile of what is true gaming, which is big campaigns and sandboxes and hex crawls or, you know, big, huge narrative epic arcs. I think it's easy to point at
my sandbox, I'm finding out lately after COVID, sandbox, for the most part, to most people, means lollygagging, meandering, milling about, players not really doing anything in your campaign. Players have settled down in your setting. They're quite content doing nothing in your game. Because you say to yourself, I'm going to let the players decide what they want to do in my campaign. Instead of just forcing them along the Disneyland ride, you know, because thank God GMs are finally becoming aware that they might be a railroader. And no one wants to be a railroader. No one wants to be caught on YouTube being a railroader. But then they do the complete opposite. There's no trains in my game. You guys just have to huff it. You're on your own, where you want to go, what you want to do. And of course the players are clueless. You know, players have no initiative. They have no proactiveness. They have no ideas. They're perfectly happy standing at an intersection for the most part. Just shooting the shit. You know, in real life, you know, players will take a smoke break during a game, right? They go outside, take a puff, come back in, continue on. Well, guess what? After a smoke break, guess what happens? The players do a smoke break in the fucking game with their characters. So, meanwhile, the GM is patient, being very patient with his players. You know, 2 hours have gone by and nothing's really happened. Eventually, the GM has to say, everyone roll for initiative, everyone roll for perception, everyone, you know. Because now combat's going to happen. Combat's the only thing that gets players to do something. Put a flame under their ass. Otherwise, nothing happens in the game. And the GMs will still call this sandbox. Sandbox. This will be a sandbox operation tonight in our game session. Yeah, right. Whatever. It's basically the GM trying to get players to do something, anything, without making them do it. Without giving away the answers to the players. That's, in a nutshell, that's what sandboxes are done as, used for in current. Oh, God damn it. I hate saying this, but we are in the 21st century and we're still role-playing like retards. But anyway.
5e's grand campaigns and the greater D&D mainstream community as the culprits for this kind of mentality. But I think this mentality stretches far back way before.
I don't know what your definition of mainstream is still. The masses, the unclean, the general population? I don't think he'll explain. I'm not going to go watch his very first video where he probably does the nomenclature for everything, all of his terms, his glossary of terms. I'm not going to go watch that.
Before 5e. When I've had these interactions, I find that I've often heard that they can't find a game that's already ongoing that they can join, or they can't make a group that they want to run for.
A D&D 5e is just a party game. At most, it's a party game. Honestly, though, this guy's bisexual coloring is annoying as fuck.
Or things like that to run their either big sandbox games or their big narrative games. And even though you absolutely can find those without that much work, it's just that, you know, you gotta know where to look and you just have to be really patient. I have found that when I have suggested to these people that, you know, maybe because of their busy schedules or, you know, other things they have in life, like families or work or school or whatever, that maybe they should try, you know, maybe a short campaign, like maybe take this adventure that's only like 5 sessions long, or maybe do a one shot here and there. I have often found that the response I get is this grumbling disagreement. And listen, I get it. When you have an idea in your head of what you want to do, other suggestions might just not seem possible in your mind because you really just want this thing and you don't really want anything else. It's kind of like when you're really hungry and you go to your fridge and there's a bunch of food in there, but nothing's really jumping out at you and you keep opening and closing it throughout the night just trying to see like, hey, maybe this time if I open it up, I'll finally find something I like. And I feel like it's very similar to that is the mentality of like, if I'm not getting this exact sandbox campaign, I don't really want it. But the thing is that if you are an adult with commitments or just not that much time, or for whatever reason you just can't make it to these games or you just got really unlucky with whatever it might be, honestly, sometimes the only way you can still partake in the hobby is doing shorter campaigns or just doing one-shots here and there when you can fit them in. And if your response to that statement is...
He's reading a script. He writes his episodes for his channel. But he still does the edits. Maybe he's like doing a PowerPoint thing and he has to do the mouse button. So he cuts out the parts where he does the mouse button to read the next part.
If you don't get to be in a big campaign, you just don't want a game. I'm going to be honest, you're going to want to just turn the video off now because you're not going to like what I have to say to you. And there's a lot more benefits to playing shorter games than just being a replacement for bigger campaigns. I still feel like right now I'm framing it as like a backup for real gaming. And that's not really the case. There's a lot of benefits to short games that you can learn a lot from and that you can have a lot of fun with that you might not be able to get.
And he's the only person I've seen on YouTube that has a phone in his hand. Maybe he's using the phone as remote, or he's a phone zombie, or he's recently stopped eating or smoking, and he has to have something in his hand to keep him entertained.
Get in a longer form game. Firstly, there's a really great satisfaction to having an end to your story as a character, and also to reach the end of a big plotline that you may have been following for a while. It is really nice to actually, you know, get those things done and seeing where things go and being able to tie it all up with a nice bow. I am obviously a big believer, like I think most people should be, that the journey is more important than the destination in a tabletop RPG, but I do just think that it is really nice to be able to look back on a campaign that's fully finished and that you can talk about where your characters ended up, and I think it's a really cool thing to be able to have.
Yeah, but okay, the way this guy plays, what are the things you can remember from a campaign? How often you rolled a 20? I would need more than that. Oh, remember when Driscoll rolled that 20? Which one? I did it 3 times during the campaign. Which time? Ugh. That's the summation of your campaign. I was like, oh, great, great. What a complete waste of time if that's all you can remember from it.
Have it from start to finish, game to see where it went. For example, a year or two ago, I ran a Shadow the Demon Lord game that was 8 sessions since we were following the book's advice of doing more condensed stories, but we hit all the epic beats of great political intrigue, a cinematic siege fight, and slaying a demon queen amongst many other cool things. I know that...
Did it happen in real time, or did it happen over the course of weeks, months? Prolonged agony of characters sitting around telling fart jokes for the most part. Nothing getting done. Do you have to watch these campaigns at 20 speed to see something happening?
That example kind of stretches the idea of what a short campaign is with 8 sessions, but I do think in terms of being able to condense all those things that you might see over the course of 6 months to 2 years, being able to do all that in just 2 months, and it was paced really well and it felt organic, it didn't feel forced.
Okay, he's got his little script in his hand. I see. He probably does one of these, blasts it to his screen so he can read it.
I didn't feel like we were just doing it just to get it done quickly. It felt really, really good, and the mechanics worked really well for that. It was really nice getting such an insane campaign done so quickly. It felt like a really, really tight season of a TV show, and honestly, was some of the most...
And honestly, whenever someone says, and honestly, watch out. Watch out what they're going to say.
Emotionally draining gaming I've ever done. Like, in a good way, but by the time we were done, we were like, that was like watching a season of Game of Thrones, you know, before it got really, really bad, where it just was insane, it was super emotional, super dramatic.
Well, at least everyone had fun, right? Okay. I don't know where he's getting this from. In his head, his players looked extremely bored. I don't know. I guess it's all about perception, how you perceive how the game went.
And we were able to do all that stuff in just 2 months. And it was extremely memorable because of that, because we had players from the beginning, and then we saw where they ended, which for about a third of the party meant they were dead. I also just wanted to use it as a bit of a compromise with people who do really, really, really want long-ass campaigns, that hey, maybe you don't want to do a 1-3 shot, but maybe you'll be down to just do a little campaign that only takes place for 2 months on a weekly basis.
Come on, get to the point, Mr. Book Writer. Why you should play one-shots. That's why I'm watching this. Rick, what did you do to me? The beginning of this video was interesting. Now it's like just a slog.
And you get all that stuff of character development and your build grows and all those other things that you get to do with your characters while not having to chain yourself to a 2-year-long commitment. I love sandbox campaigns and long narrative campaigns. I'm currently running Reach the Roach God, and I've been running that for a few months now, and I'm going to be running it for a few months more. There's a lot of satisfaction in running a long campaign that you build up, you have a lot of prep time to do, you see characters over a long period of time develop and grow, and there just is inherently a crapload of satisfaction in that. But I don't think it's a more legitimate way to play. It's not, you know, a more true, pure form of roleplaying. It's just a different way. The same way a hex crawl isn't any better than a point crawl, and a point crawl isn't any better than a mega dungeon. They're just different ways to experience the hobby. I've also used one-shots as a great primer to get an idea of somebody new trying to join the group. You get a good idea of, do they jive with us, like, personality-wise? Do their play styles match? Do they like my GMing? Because they might also not like your group. There's a lot of things there that if you do it in just a one-shot or a two-shot or whatever, you can get a pretty good idea if this thing works, and if it doesn't, you're not in a huge commitment, and then you can also go separate ways after that. There's not really much awkwardness, because, you know.
You would think that, okay, the 99 percenters, right? They all roleplay the same way. You would think that, or how should I say this? Wouldn't it, does it sound weird that someone in the game's like, this isn't the right fit for me? I don't know how often that happens. It should happen a whole lot more than it does. Because there are times I'll be watching someone's actual play and they're just, so many players in the table are horrible. Like, why are they still in the group? Why haven't they been kicked? You can see who's role-playing and who isn't. And the people that don't role-play just drag everything down to their level. And after a while, the role-player at the table just stops talking. They don't put as much effort into the game session. But they still hang out with the group. I don't understand. Why doesn't that person leave? But I think it's more rare than not for a player to say something like, sorry, but your group isn't a benefit. It is a hindrance to the hobby. How often does a player ever say that? Usually the player's like, hey, I'm in a campaign. I'm in a time-wasting campaign for 2 years with some strangers I don't even know. That probably happens a lot. Until they get a girlfriend, then they're gone. They stop coming to the game because they got a girlfriend.
Games fall apart all the time, so if you had a campaign plan at some point, but you just ended up not telling them about it because, you know, after the two-shot, you kind of realize, oh, like, oh, hey, like, you're a huge min-maxer, and, like, that's really cool and all, but I'm not really into that. I kind of want to run for people who are way more narrative-focused or whatever it might be. And the other thing, too, is that...
Well, how about you say that to the player before you do one-shots? For God's sakes. Don't just invite random people to your game sessions. I used to. Not no more.
That this can also break the ice if there's somebody you don't know that well, because once you start that campaign, if you already have some familiarity, you don't really need to get through those awkward phases of, you know, seeing how far they want to go with role-playing, see what they want to do. If you get a better idea before that, you can kick off your campaign.
Okay, now he's throwing around the word role-play like it means something. What does role-play mean to this guy? Does it mean funny voices? Does it mean reading from a book to the players, telling a story? It's weird. Some people think that role play means telling a story to your players. That's role play. I don't know how that could possibly be, but it is a thing.
A way that works for them and you. The best campaign today that I've run so far, in my opinion, is this 9-month long DCC Lightmar game I ran for my home group, which was unfortunately prematurely killed by 2020 in
the dark times.
But before I ran that campaign for everybody, I ran some one-shots for some prospective players in our area, and one of those players was a fantastic fit for our group, and is one of my favorite players to this day. The other thing as well, people not only new to your group, but new to the hobby, is that you might have a much harder time trying to get them into your crunchy, fancy system of choice to play a year or 2 year long campaign, than if you try and, you know, come up with like maybe a rules light system that you might find like Trophy Dark or DCC or Old School Essentials or whatever.
Okay, let's say you have a crunchy rule set for your campaign. The players aren't really doing anything. They don't role play. They're just being told to roll dice and crap like that. Then you decide, well, my players have said something about using lighter rules for some reason, so we're going to try a lighter rule set for our campaign moving, you know, going forward. That's even less for your players to do. Your players are going to do less, if anything, because the rules are less. I don't understand. Are the players all of a sudden going to become role players because there's less rules in the game now? Are they all going to become writers and info dump what their character's doing back to the GM, who's info dumping what the scenery is doing to them? You know, all the players instantly become writers because there's less rules? I don't understand this. What mentality is this? I don't understand.
And just pitch a, hey, let's just do a single session, let's do, you know, 2 or 3 sessions, whatever. Then you get them hooked with a much easier system, and then if you really, really want to try and get them into the game that you really want to play, let's say 5e Pathfinder, you might have a much better chance doing it that way than immediately springing, hey, I want to do this, here's all the rules, here's your build, it's going to take us all night to do this, and also, are you good to commit for a 6-month period? You might just have a little bit better luck if you just go, hey, let's just do a single session. You know, I got this adventure called Winter's Daughter, should be pretty fun, we'll just do characters up in like 2 seconds, and we'll just get...
You guys can meander in a one-shot, or you can meander even slower in the grand scheme of things in my 2-year campaign. Is this game any good? Is this one of those weird games that's not really a game? A frustrated writer wrote this game. Is that what this is? Is that what I'm seeing here?
Plan. I've also found that one-shots are a great way to learn as both game master and player. Running an adventure and knowing there's a time limit is a great way to train your pacing skills. One of the best things you can learn as a GM is how to pace games properly. It helps you keep engaged players, and also helps you keep the plot moving forward at a pace that you want to move.
Okay, you should know how to pace a game before you start a game. If you're a book reader, and you love the slow-ass pacing of H.P. Lovecraft, guess what your game is going to be like? If you like movies that are fast-paced, you know, normal-paced movies, you know, none of this romantic time travel crap where the guy with a penny just walks around meeting a woman, he's meeting the womans, and the movie's basically a walking simulator. There are movies like that, you know, Message in a Bottle, those kinds of movies. Or is there like some action, a guy just driving to work and he goes off the edge. He's unhinged. He doesn't make it to his job. Instead, he starts hacksawing at fire hydrants and then shooting at random police cars driving by. That sounds like an action. That could be a possible action involved in that game session. The action is in the movie, therefore the action is in the game. Anyway, you gotta know pacing. Don't. If your players are in a tavern for longer than 5 minutes, something's wrong with your game's pacing.
Move at. And pacing isn't just important for one-shots, it's really important for long campaigns, because I don't know about you, but one of the most dreaded questions I hate hearing, especially in long campaigns, which is when it happens, is when you get the players doing something, and then they kind of just go, wait, what are we doing here again? And that's usually because you had the quest giver give them the quest about...
Because the players don't say where they're at and what they're doing. And they didn't take any notes when they were told by an NPC what they're supposed to do, where they're supposed to go, who they're supposed to see. What they didn't write down, they didn't copy paste the info dump to their journal. They're there to, the players just want to kill stuff and get XP. That's what the game's for, is to get XP, right? The whole point of playing these fucking games is to get XP, right?
6 sessions ago. But 6 sessions ago was 4 months ago, because your buddy Jerry doesn't make your game a priority because he has a really busy life, but he wants to play. And then you guys end up only playing like every other week because he keeps failing. And the other people who, you know, Wolf Jerry's not.
Yeah, this guy did some actual plays with just one player. And no one was showing up to his game. I was like, okay, that's kind of sad. What is it? Back in the day, you would say, do better. Now it's get good. What's the phrase, catchphrase for next year going to be?
Not playing. I don't really want to play. Because we have this idea that we only do long-term campaigns of the campaign we're doing, so we don't really get games in, and, you know, over time, people just kind of forget or lose track of what you're actually doing.
If one of your game sessions in your campaign is just combat, just out of context combat, guess what? That was a one shot. You had a war game as a one shot. Congratulations.
As you could tell, I'm clearly not holding on to anything. And when you play more one shots, you get to try out different styles and different systems, and you can learn a lot of different things from those games that you can then take into other games.
Oh, no.
I started playing Trophy Dark in the middle.
No! No! Shoot me if I take game mechanics from one game and use them in another game. Shoot me if I do that.
Of 2023, and it became probably one of my favorite games of recent times. I absolutely love it. It is a fantastic one-shot system, and one of the best things it taught me is how to ask players questions. The way Trophy Dark tries to get you to ask questions of players.
Are these in-character questions? Just asking.
Is a great way to sort of give them a little bit of a breadcrumb of inspiration or a place to springboard off of, instead of catching them with like deer in the headlights with just a really broad question out of nowhere, or like with not really much to jump off of. As an example of what I mean, instead of hitting players with tell me about your hometown, ask them something like, how do the smells of the market square remind you of home? Or what aspects of this demon idol make you uneasy? Or what is it about this orc chief that reminds you that you'll never repair your relationship with your father, Jerry? I have found these leading or more structured questions have a bit more of that yes and improv factor than just a blank question that doesn't really have much.
These are therapy questions. What are you doing? Running a game as a therapy session?
To grasp onto. And you know, some players are pretty good with that. They're, you know, pretty good at just coming up with anything, or they already have an idea of who they are and what they want to do with their character. But a lot of players don't, especially when all your energy and focus has gone into making a really good build, or that you just aren't used to that kind of style of play. So just coming up.
How does Johnny feel so far about this session? What the rest of you, how do you feel about what Johnny has done in this session?
The stuff on the fly from a pretty broad question might not be your strength. I have found these questions give the players a little bit of a string that they can grab and pull on, instead of just a big blank wall that they don't really have much to work with. Also,
they're not role players. If they're not doing anything, I guess they're not role players then, huh? This guy is, you can tell he's aching to tell stories to his players. He's aching. Don't understand. Why do people want to tell stories to their players? How about this? Write a book? Put it on RPG. No, what is it? Books. What is it? Drive-through books. Tell your friends to buy it and read it.
Speaking of Trophy Dark, I did a Trophy Dark actual play not too long ago.
Oh no, it's called, what is it called? It's called Drive-Through Fiction. That's the one. Hey, what's weird is the book I wrote on art on Drive-Thru RPG, it migrated to like eight other servers. So it's getting downloaded from, I guess the book is universal that I wrote, so it's on everything except I don't think it's on Drive-Thru Comics. But it's weird how it just migrated out there. And I said to the guys, what's going on there? I said, oh. I don't remember what they said. It was a computer. It was a computer response. Something about it meets the criteria or something. It's a criteria thing. Expanding horizons, basically. I'm like, oh, okay. So maybe I'll get questions from people who downloaded it from the non-RPG sites. That'll be interesting. I'm reading your book. I have questions.
And I think that one deserves a lot more love. I think personally, it's one of the best actual plays on the channel. Once it gets going, it really gets going, and I think a lot of you would enjoy it. So check it out on my channel or go to my actual play podcast and check it out there. And just like those structured questions, I find the more systems and different styles of play I do, the more I learn and the more things I take from other systems and start kind of making this Frankenstein monster play style when it comes to all my different games I play. And it's a lot easier to play those different systems when the commitment is just one night. Not to mention, those might give opportunities to players to try out characters or archetypes or builds or different ideas they might not otherwise gravitate towards. But when they don't have to worry about it being such a long commitment that they're going to be stuck with that character that they might not like, you know, somebody usually plays a fighter type who is trying out a cleric, trying out a support, seeing if they like it, because who knows? You might do that and realize, oh my god, this is such a fun style of play. I had no idea it was this fun, or that like this game provides this sort of support class or fighting class in a way that is lacking in other systems. And I'm learning I don't dislike that archetype. I dislike how that system does that archetype. And I think that's a great way for a lot of players to learn about themselves and what they like.
How about this? Don't use archetypes. I don't use archetypes. I don't use tropes. I don't use cliches.
To play. I'm just gonna be brutally honest right now. I don't think the worst players are 5e players like a lot of people in our neck of the woods would make you think. The worst players are people who refuse to try new games, new playstyles, or refuse to even see why a design choice might be made just on the basis that it's different than what they're used to. If you
Okay, did he just call all the D&D 5e players retarded? Because they refused to try something else?
have the time and the money, I really think it's worth your while as a hobbyist to try out different things, really get a good idea of things that are out there in our hobby. If you play with different people and different games, you can really learn.
I don't think D&D 5e players are hobbyists. I don't think they see this as a hobby. I really do not think so. Even in the 70s, you got kids playing AD&D. Was it a hobby for them? Was it just something to kill time with? Was it just a fun game? Was it because they didn't have home computers yet in their house, so they had to play it by hand? Was it a hobby? When does D&D become a hobby? That should be a video. Anyone who's made it this far, 33 minutes, 37 seconds. Anyone who's made it this far, please make a video on what you think. When does D&D become a hobby for a player? The person collecting the books, the RPG collector, is it a hobby? Why do you have so many RPG books? Oh, it's a hobby of mine. I'm a collector, you see. Or is it the DM who's writing their own game system? Is it a hobby at that point for the player? They're so much into the hobby that they want to make their own game? Or is it just a cash grab thing? It's not a hobby at all. It's just I'm merely trying to earn a secondary income. Hopefully passive passive income. Oh, what's the other The guy who likes tweaking, home brewing. That's all he does is home brew. Or the guy who likes making mega dungeons. I'm guessing it's probably a hobby. Spending all that time making a mega dungeon, hoping that one day he'll get to run it for his players? Or is he more like just a creative person who likes to draw, likes to world build? That's his passion. Maybe he hasn't noticed it's a hobby yet, because his hobby is watching football. But mega dungeon creation, is that a hobby too? Does that get in the way of his ham radio hobby? Anyway, so make a video, everyone, and explain yourself. When did you see this as a hobby instead of just, another game in the closet with Monopoly and Battleship?
What you like and what you don't like. And trust me, learning what you don't like is really, really helpful before commit to a big game and then you realize after character creation, holy shit, I.
Oh no, I made a character and there's no XP or leveling up in this game? Oh no. Whatever should I do? How do I play my character in such a fashion?
Really don't like this. And I would have known I don't like this if I had just played more games that were like this one. But I thought, oh, well, my buddy's finally wanting to GM and I don't want to GM anymore. I'm a forever GM or whatever. I hate that term. But a lot of people, feel that way. And then their other friend decides to do it. And then they go, oh, shit. If I had known that this is what it was, if I had known that Shadowrun was hell and I had tried it once in a little, pickup three shot that I had seen online, I would have known to tell my.
Yeah, I like these guys that say stuff like, "Oh, I funded, I oh, what is it called? Not funded. What do they say? They say they did something with Kickstarter or they did something with Indiegogo. What is it people say they did? I did something. I kicked it? No, what do they say? Anyway, whatever they say. Afterwards, they'll say, "As soon as I get the hardcover book, I'm gonna run a 3-year campaign with my players. I can't wait." Sight unseen, they're already planning a 3-year campaign with their existing player group. And I was like, what? And then this happened with Traveler 5, the first Kickstarter for Traveler 5. It came out, people were very disappointed. That was the. You've heard of the little black books? Well, this is the big black book that came out. Almost 800 pages. Hardcover. People are like, what is this? $99 for this? What did I just get in the mail from Kickstarter? What is this? I was the guy saying, I was the guy constantly saying, I'm gonna get my popcorn when someone says, I went to Kickstarter and I got the book, waiting for it to ship to me. I can't wait to run it for my gamers. I'm like, oh, I would just comment in the forums. I'll have my popcorn ready for this one. And people are like, what is he talking about? What do you mean? Driscoll, what are you saying? What do you mean, popcorn? Well, they found out what I was talking about.
My buddy to stay far away from it. Personally, every time I try something new, I find I'm always learning and improving as a hobbyist. And I feel like the moment you stop wanting to learn and try new things is the moment you stagnate in your skills. On the player side, I think there's a lot of similar things they can learn in terms of new play styles and things they might enjoy and new experiences and all that. But I think the biggest thing a lot of players could stand to learn is to.
How to role play? Just do a practice session. Learn to role play. Grown ass people, so-called playing role playing games, and none of them are role playing in the game. There's a Greek term for that. What is that? What's the right term for that? The Greek one or Latin? No, there's a Latin. What is it called when you're contradicting, you're the complete opposite? It's like military intelligence. There's a term for that. Non sequitur? Are the players doing non sequituring? when they say they're a role player, and you're like, oh, really? Oh, yeah. I've been role playing for 30 plus years since BX. And I'm like, oh, really? And then it's like, okay, how am I not surprised when you hear them talk about their game or their players milling around in YouTube discussions, recapping videos, then you see an actual play of it and you're like, these guys are all liars. They're all lying to themselves. Usually the GM says, well, me and my players had our first session last night. First time playing such and such. Not a mention of role play. 3 hour long recap video, session recap, and no mention of role play. If anything, it's just a recap of a story that was being told to the players because they played a text adventure by hand. Sad as it is, that's how most games are run. But anyway, yeah, he always has a phone in his hand. I don't know if any other YouTuber does that.
To finally understand the benefit of pre-generated characters. One of my biggest pet peeves in this hobby is this weird as fuck aversion that a lot of players have to pre-generate characters, and I know where it.
Pre-generate, pre-generate, post-generate, pre-gen. Okay. I'm gonna make a pre-gen character for my game. Okay, tell us your sad story of woe.
Comes from, but it doesn't make it any less stupid. And you don't need to do pre-gens for all one-shots. Some one-shots really benefit from it, but some games like Cairn, you can make your character in less than a minute, and you don't really need a pre-gen for that when you can just do it yourself real quick. But they can be absolutely amazing, and they are.
I could argue about this all day, every day. If you can make a character in like 5 minutes, the game is shit, your character is shit. Your players will be shit. What difference does it make? I made my character in like less than 5 minutes. Can we just play the stupid fucking game already? Somebody give me a diet roll.
Or no less your character just because you didn't have a hand in making every aspect of it from minute one. I know this topic is going to get a lot of pushback because this is a very strongly.
Me, I'm a random character generator type guy. I don't do point buy. I'm not a point buy guy. I want random characters. I got several random character generators for different games, primarily Traveler. I hit the generate button. Boom, I got a character. That's my character. People lose their mind. They see me do that in the video. Driscoll, you're just gonna roll. You just roll. You do know that's a random character you just picked, right? See, role players, they can't fathom that. They can't. Even the ones the so-called role players in the so-called RPG community, they've been playing D&D their whole life for some crazed reason. They go nuts. They go nuts when they hear about random character generation. It's like how on earth are you gonna. They're trying to say, how on earth are you going to role play that character without saying the word role play? Because role play is not in their vernacular. And they get frustrated because they can't speak because they're missing words from their RPG vocabulary. It's very frustrating for them.
Debate a topic amongst a lot of people, but I want to tell you a little story that really made me realize just how good pre-gens can be. A few years ago, when I got into Call of Cthulhu.
Okay. I'll give pregens, laminated pregens. I'll give them out to people. They can write on them or whatever. And for like a half hour session, learning to teach the game mechanics. Sometimes they get a pre-gen and we use it for a one-shot in the hopes of, after the session, the players say, I want to make a new character. They don't say that was fun. They say that was fucking cool. I want to make a new character for the next session. I'm like, okay. I act like I had nothing to do with their all of a sudden interest in the role play scene.
While my group was still playing 5e, I kind of branched off while they kept doing that, and I got with some other locals and started playing COC with them. They were all pretty new players. They were really great guys, and they were pretty fun role players. But overall, a lot of their characters kind of lacked in the depth department.
I'm Indiana Jones, and Cthulhu's in the sewers. I'm going to throw dynamite into the sewers until Cthulhu is dead. That's how you play Call of Cthulhu if you don't know anything about H.P. Lovecraft. And you're just randomly tossed into a game session like that.
That was, of course, until I ran Reign of Terror for them and gave them the pregens that were made for that adventure. That short 3-session game where they played pregens was the best role-playing I had seen them do by a mile. It was not...
Oh, he said role-playing, finally. Okay, what is your definition of role-play, I wonder?
Not even close. Their last characters were all kind of stiff and, you know, didn't really have all much going on. They were kind of just them plus, you know, a lot.
Oh, so not role-playing then. It was just the players playing themselves with the things on their character sheet that they were good at.
That was very much just not really, I don't want to say not interesting, because I think that's going too far in the other direction. They were just kind of mid, you know, they were average. They were okay, they weren't terrible, but they weren't going to win any awards. But the way these three played these soldiers, they took the characteristics, the flaws, the bonds between them, the way they took that and really elevated it, I was so blown away.
There's a word for that. What is that called? You lower your expectations so much. And then something happens and you're like, I'm blown away by my players. They did stuff without me asking them, what do you do first? It was an amazing session. I only said, what do you guys do, like 40 times instead of 100 times. It was a fucking amazing session we had.
They did such a good job that I've run a lot of COC since then, and that is still one of the best little mini COC campaigns I've run. And yet, when we finished playing it, and they talked about how much fun they had, we went over the different crazy things that had happened and everything else, they all said, that was really fun, but next time I'd like to make my own character. And that really...
That's how it works. That's how it's supposed to be.
...really baffled me, because they had easily done the best job they had done. They had fully made these characters their own.
Oh no, the GM. Getting worried that his players may surpass his roleplay skills. Oh no, I am the forever GM. You are the forever players in my group. You cannot surpass my abilities at the table here. You will not grow as players in my group. You will stay static. Do you understand me? Static.
But for some reason, that need to have every little bit of say over the characters from the...
I like it when the pupil is now the master. I like it when that happens. That is so cool. You find a player that is really into the hobby, into the role play, wants to go out, fend for themselves, find a system they like, maybe write their own game. Who knows? I like it when that happens. You don't want your players to stay, you know, you don't want your players to have arrested development. Mentally, they're still playing like they're 14 after 30 years. They're still playing like they're 14-year-olds. They haven't grown. They haven't advanced. They haven't gotten better at the hobby. They still do Mother May I questions. It's like, don't... People get attached to their friends, their old players. It's tradition. He's always in our sessions. He's always been there. He is the anchor of our group. And they're like, this guy can't roleplay with shit. What? What do you mean he can't roleplay? We're all role players here, aren't we, boys? Yeah.
Their names, their stats, to everything, even for a short little game, was still there. And I did not understand it at all because they had done so much better. We had way more fun than we had in any of their games. It was such like an S-tier game compared to everything else we had done. I did not understand why they still really were against pre-gen.
Okay, well, I watched his sessions. He went from S-tier to S-tier 2. You know, you get better cameras, better microphones, a better VTT, I suppose, but your game is still shit.
Gens. And I realize for Call of Cthulhu, pre-made investigators are a much bigger part of that community because a lot of times you have all these characters with different skills and you kind of want characters that work for the mystery. You know, you want characters that have electrical repair or drive auto or whatever things that might be. You know, if you're running an adventure that's on a big boat, maybe having somebody who has, you know, marine biology or natural world or mechanical repair would be pretty good to have. So a lot of times they're just kind of made there so that you can make them your own, but they have sort of the skills you might need.
Hey, how do you prevent your players from doing Scooby-Doo in Call of Cthulhu? How do you do that?
And some flaws that might be attached to the mystery. And so that's a much more accepted thing in the COC community that you do pre-gens because...
There's two kinds of Call of Cthulhu games out there by the general public. You know, the filthy pedestrians out there. Groovy Ghoulies. Scooby-Doo, actually there's three, and Clue. Those are the three ways you play Call of Cthulhu with randos off the street.
It's just easier, and I think that mentality against it is a lot of bleed over from D&D 5e, 3.5, Pathfinder, whatever, a lot of the big build games. And I understand why you want those to be your own. To be clear, because I know a lot of people are probably...
Did he say big build games?
You want those to be your own. To be clear, because I know a lot of people are probably already typing comments that they are really mad at me for saying this or that they completely disagree. But to be clear, I understand why you want that to be your own. Because with those games, you are making a build. You are making like a whole character that isn't just like a character and a person that you kind of realize a personality. Probably already typing comments that they are really mad at. A lot of bleed over from D&D 5e, 3.5, Pathfinder, whatever. A lot of the big build games.
You don't start as just a common farmer anymore in those games. Your character fits on an index card at the start of the game. That's not a thing anymore. Am I hearing that in these newer games, these ugly ass art books, you start as a superhero already in the game? You're a superhero character, but fucking fantasy style with anime crap. Is that what I'm hearing? I guess that would be a build, right? How long does it take you to make a character in D&D 5e? Anyone? How about Pathfinder 2.0? How long does it take to make a character that won't die?
And I understand why you want those to be your own. To be clear, because I know a lot of people are probably already typing comments that they are really mad at me for saying this or that they completely disagree. But to be clear,
The saddest part about the tabletop RPG hobby as a whole, the saddest part for the 99%ers, their favorite RPG will always be the one they learned first. And guess what? Guess what? More people are playing this in this shit hobby now than ever before. And guess what their favorite first game is? D&D 5e. We're stuck with, like, the next 30 years, these complete losers, with their D&D 5e. Oh, the newer games suck. The classic D&D, in my opinion, of all time, is D&D 5e. That's the edition I learned on. That's the edition I played for years with. You're going to hear this 30 years from now. All these fuckers, because D&D 5e was the first game they ever played. And that I'm talking about the 99 percenters now. It's going to be shit. For 30 years, it's just the whole RPG community arena, the RPG space, as it were. It's going to be shit for 30 years. Absolute shit. If you're in the 99%. If you're in the 1%, you're okay. You'll make it. You'll have an excellent time.
I understand why you want that to be your own, because with those games, you are making a build, you are making like a whole character that isn't just like a character and a person that you kind of realize the personality parts. You also have to figure out, how do they fight? You know, what abilities do they have? How do they deal with puzzles, everything else? So I totally get why you want to make that your own, because there's so many aspects that you'd like your own hand in, which I get. And especially, to be clear, I think for a longer campaign, I think pre-gens are not really the way to go for the most part, except for very specific circumstances, or if the group just likes it and they're happy with that. I get it.
Wouldn't that be neat if, you know, you're at a game store and you see these weirdos at a table and they're playing their D&D game. And they say they've been playing the campaign. This campaign's been going on for 2 years now. And you're like, oh, really? Oh, yeah, every Friday night. Forever. Basically, we've been here playing this game. This is our table. You're at our table, dude. This is our table every Friday. You're like, oh, really? And then you find out through a normal conversation, I guess, that the players have been using pregen. They all started the campaign with the pregen character. What? That would blow my mind. I would just be blown away. I would have to watch. I would have to like pull up a chair and sit there at the table as an audience member, an audience participant, and see how they roleplay after 2 years still with a pre-gen character. I would be so, you know, when they're all joking and they're not doing anything in the game, I'll say, so tell me, how is it that you're still using your pre-gen characters? Someone's probably going to say, oh, they were the most balanced characters for our party. We wanted a balanced party. Okay. Oh, I'm gonna leave you guys alone then. I'm gonna let you guys go at it then. I'm gonna go find another table that has more sanity points.
Even for COC, if people are doing, like, say, Horror on the Orient Express, that they might want to make their own character because they're like, listen, we're going to be playing this character for, like, the next year. I mean, they're probably going to die before
hang
that.
On,
or
hang on, hang on,
year.
Hang on.
I mean, they're hang happy on, hang with on. That. I get it even for COC if people are doing, like, say, Horror on the Orient Express.
I've seen this book somewhere. Where have I seen this? London to the Alps. I have seen this. Anyone I know? Anyone I know? Nope. Nope. Where have I seen this before? This is, I remember covers on games and stuff. I'm like, oh, wow. But I can't remember. Is this from 10 years ago? Is this from a week ago? Is it, you know. Interesting. Would you get on a train that even looks remotely like this? Or did the train turn into this after you got on it? Or is it a legend that the train may not even exist and you're trying to get a ticket ride on the thing, but it's always booked for some reason?
Express that they might want to make their own character because they're like, listen, we're going to be playing this character for like the next year. I mean, they're probably going to die before that in Horror, but same thing in 5-year Pathfinders. I'm going to be playing this character for a long time. We have time to make it ourselves. We can just make a session zero. So to be clear, I totally get making your own character in those long form games, but I do think for shorter games, you creating your own character, regardless of how it ties into the story or with the time limit.
Okay, again, I use pre-gens to get players. I want to start new players role-playing as soon as possible. The sooner the better. I'm not going to have players show up in a stream and then we're sitting around for 2 hours making characters. What if they don't like making characters? And then by then everyone's like worn out, they have things to do, the game doesn't start, you know, that kind of nonsense. Well, we'll meet, I guess we'll meet up then next week. We'll have a game next week. Bring your character sheets. I don't want to be that guy having to say that in a stream. No, I pass out pre-made characters. You know, basically splat templates on the table. Players peruse them, see which ones they want to be in the game. And we do a test, a little test run, as it were. You know, if the player is interested in combat, we'll do some simple combat, out of character combat, just to get the players to learn the combat rules. If they want to roleplay without dice, and they want to roleplay the character doing stuff, they're not really interested in the dice thing yet. They don't, you know, dice? This game uses dice? I didn't know you needed dice for a role-playing game, you know, that kind of person. Fine, well, we won't use dice. I just want to see if they can roleplay. I just want to see if how they handle stress, duress, that kind of thing. Crank up the difficulty levels. And I say yes and no but, that kind of thing, without rolling dice. Because I already know I made the character, so I already know how good the character is at doing something. I want to see how the players roleplay failures, successes, that kind of thing. Are they a sore loser? Do they get all giddy like a schoolgirl when they succeed at the most mundane things? I want to know if the players, what the player does, what their reactions are to things. If they can just stay in character, that would just be nice. They usually do. A new player usually stays in character. They don't know any better. They don't know that you can play these games without role-playing, so I trick them.
In mind is not an inherently superior choice just because you created it. Taking a pre-generated character and making it your own is every bit as legitimate, if not superior in some cases. At the end of the day, all I'm saying is that playing a pre-gen is not breaking some invisible rule, it's not taking a shortcut or making you a worse role player. The same way running an RPG module does not make you a worse GM than if you just run everything from scratch. I've also found out long campaigns.
Okay, running modules, I'm okay with it. I treat modules as a setting, and we're going to sandbox in the module. Instead of going through the module in a linear fashion, a linear story fashion, instead of doing that, we are going to just, the players get to do whatever they want within the boundaries of the module. They'll meet NPCs out of order. That's fine. There's going to be things the players don't learn during the game because they didn't visit a certain area at a certain time. The ghost lady made her appearance, but the players weren't there. She left, never to be seen or heard from again. It's okay. Players don't need to know every detail. They don't have to know every mystery in the module. They're probably, the players are probably too busy trying to stay alive, you know? They have more important things. More important things came up in the game. And it's interesting to them. And as long as it's real time still and they're not loitering, you know, no one wants loiterers hanging around in a graveyard for hours. You don't want that. The caretaker or whatever, he doesn't want people on his property. Especially after closing hours. The players in the tavern, again, you don't want players sitting around in a tavern lollygagging. The beauty with new players is they don't know how to lollygag. They came to roleplay. They were told, this is the beauty. This is, I find this the beautifulest thing ever. New players who've never played these games before. It's a thing of amazement when you tell a random person that we're going to role play. We're going to try some role play. And they look at you like, this isn't any of that commie bullshit stuff, is it? You know, like the guy from Dr. Strangelove. You're not trying to pull any of that commie perverted stuff, are you? Mandrake just needs change. He just needs change to make a telephone call to the president of the United States. Use the bullets. This is what he says. Shoot the lock off. That's what the bullets are for. You want me to damage personal company property? Shoot the lock off. Anyway. I like to role play crap from those movies. But the anyway, point is, you have a new person on the block. Tell them you're gonna role play. And then you do the role play, and they're like, they're amazed. They're happy, they're thrilled, they're engaged. Why is it stopping now? We were role playing such cool stuff. What do you mean, game over, man? You know, that kind of thing. If you teach a person to role play, guess what happens? That person teaches a person how to role play. Now, if I did the reverse, if I said we're going to role play and then I ran a game, like any schluck, any schlum, they would say to themselves, well, that was weird. I don't know if I was entertained or bored or what. Hard to say. Maybe I'm not good at this. Maybe I don't understand what I was supposed to do. I was told there was going to be role play. I don't think I did role play per se in this game. It seemed to be just me rolling dice and trying to kill something and hit points and nonsense. And they're going to take that with them for the rest of their life. They're not going to teach anyone to play that way. They're not going to play the game again. They might join other games and they'll just be ready for the mediocrity when they join someone's game because they've been in a crap game session already in their life, so they don't expect anything. They hear that word role play and they just kind of like it fades off in the distance. It's like, okay, role play. And there's that term again, role play. I heard that years ago. Someone told me we were going to role play and it never happened. And here we are. They say it's going to be a role play game session. Okay. Not sure what the role play thing is, but they say they role play. All these guys say they role play, and then the game is just as crap as they remembered it being. And they're like, oh, I guess this is how the hobby's done. I guess this is how these games are played. And that's how you end up with the current situation we're in with the worst fucking role players in the history of planet Earth. You would think that with the YouTubes, with the telephones, the goddamn electricity in everyone's house, people would be geniuses at this point in the hobby. But no. There's still feral players, feral kids living in sewers, barely able to read. Actually, people have gotten even dumber since the 60s and 70s. People can't even fucking read now. They want to be in your game. And all they know how to do is, text on their phone, like they're texting out car license plates to each other. That's their vocabulary. I knew this would be a thing. In the 70s, I knew this would be a thing. People were typing later, TTY. TTY. People were typing that on the mainframes. And I resisted. I never did that. I never typed smiley face on the terminals. I don't do emojis. I don't do the anythings. emoticon. I don't do any of that kind of crap. I don't do that shit. And I spared myself from that torment. And the people born in the late 90s, that's all they do. Unless they're intelligent, that's all they do is post crap like that on their phones. It's considered literature.
Hands can have burnout on both the GM side and the player side. And doing little one-shots to shake things up can be a really, really fun way to reinvigorate your players, get them re-engaged. And you can have these one-shots take place in the same world, and maybe these will be backups for later if somebody dies, or, you know, maybe...
But here's the secret, though. The ugly secret that no one wants to talk about. Your fucking game sessions in your campaigns are one-shots. You got players coming and going. I'll be there Friday. I'll be in the game. Yeah, I'll be there. They show up 1 week. They're not there the next week. It's a one shot. It's a series of fucking one shots. Stretched into some campaign story thing. You got all these one shots tied together by some loosely knit story of yours. Campaign. Who goes to a movie to watch a campaign? No one.
Before there's a part of the story, or you can do a completely different world or system just to get, you know, a real shake of things so that people can, you know, get back to the game and be happy playing again now that they got, you know, a little bit of a different taste of something else. At least for me, it's been really nice after doing the same thing for a while to just try out something different and sort of see what else might be out there. I think that covers pretty much everything I wanted to cover in this video for why people should play one-shots and shorter campaigns. I do know that a lot of this probably very much comes off like I'm saying if you don't play one-shots or if you don't play shorter arc games, then you are a worse player, which I know I said at the beginning, that's not what I'm saying.
Oh, you're one of those people. I hear that all the time. Shauner is one of those one-shot people. He only does one-shots. One-shot, one-shot. But then when you watch their game, it's like you're treating each game session of your long-ass campaign as one-shots. They themselves say they loathe one-shots. They hate one-shots. Yet they're playing a one-shot every week in their campaign. What's the difference? Just random... You know, they say one-shots are just random killing sprees, gonzo, just anything goes because, it's, you know, it's a one-shot. Who cares? It's just a one-shot. It's not like we're going to be... doing this all, you know, forever. And then they're doing that same crap in their campaign. What hilarity will ensue this week in our campaign, I wonder? You know, the GM asks the players, how do you feel about this game so far? What do you think is going to happen in this session? Just start the fucking game. Oh, that's right. It's a one-shot stringed together with other one-shots. I forgot. Proceed. Anyway, I'm done. I'm so done with this.